All right, ladies and gentlemen, let's get started. We are going to continue our discussion of melody. And last Thursday, we were talking about melody in terms of scales, major scales, minor scales, chromatic scales. Then we went on to talk a little bit about what it is in a melody that makes us feel the way we do about that particular melody, the major and minor quality of them, and the fact that that quality shows up rather early on in the scale, the third step of the scale. Then we talked about conjunct melodies and disjunct melodies, and we ended up talking about Beethoven's Ode to Joy, which he incorporated in the last movement of his last symphony, Symphony No. 9. And we said that that had a particular quality of phrase construction, antecedent consequent phrase structure. Opening it up. And closing it back down. And I was thinking over the weekend of all the pieces that operate that way. Antecedent. Consequent. Then it goes on with an extension, the way Beethoven went on with an extension. Antecedent. Consequent. I was thinking of a piece of Mozart. Let's listen here just to a little bit of what that really is. Okay? Linda, go ahead, play it. Sorry. All right, that's enough of that. Dumb pet trick, right? Okay, dumb pet trick. All I did was take the theme of the Macarena and strip away all the rhythmic stuff underneath and put an 18th century Alberti bass with it that Mozart would have used. And so on. But the point here is that even the Macarena is using this antecedent and consequent phrase structure, something as basic as that. So it's sort of endemic to how melodies are constructed. Now, I was thinking, and I always like to try to come up with new, however, albeit lame brain ideas for teaching this class. Supposing I got a student up here, I mean melody. What makes a melody beautiful? What makes a great melody? Anybody know? Well, if you do, let me know, because I don't know, and nobody really knows. It's sort of like the definition of pornography. You kind of know it when you see it, or you know it when you hear it. So in pursuit of this, I was trying to think, well, maybe I'll have a student come up and try to craft a melody right here on the spot. And I suppose we could play with that, but then I said, well, that's probably not a good idea, because A, no student would really want to do this, and B, it would probably take too long to work through all the aspects of it. So what I did, and this was about 4 o'clock yesterday afternoon, I thought, well, all right, Craig, you think up a melody. So I started thinking up a melody, and I hope I can remember how it went. Something like that. So what would you give me as a grade for that melody? Come on now. Daniel, what do I get for that melody? B minus, C plus, B? Well, this is great in days of great inflation, so I've been inflated up to a B, but it was kind of C, C minus. It wasn't particularly inspired. But in crafting that, it made me think of, well, why do I do this at this particular point and not that? Well, there's certain parameters, certain confines that we're operating with. We've got to be in a scale. Certain kinds of phrases, something ending like that in a piece that's going to end here, tells me that's got to be in the middle. That can't come at the end. So there's a syntax here also. We've talked about that before, that musical phrases have to come in a particular order for them to make sense. So instead of working with my lame brain melody, let's work with a great one. We're going to work with a melody by Giacomo Puccini here. And you can see his name on the board up there and get a sense of the melody in question. It's an aria, and we'll talk about what an aria is later, but it's an aria from his opera, Gianni Schicchi. Now, that's not a well-known opera by Puccini. Can anybody tell me the name of a better-known opera by Puccini? Tosca, yep. Madame Butterfly, haven't hit the most obvious one yet. La Boheme, for example. All Rent was based on La Boheme. So he's written a lot of well-known operas. This happens to be a lesser-known opera, but it has one sort of drop-dead beautiful melody in the thing. O mio bambino caro, where a young lady is trying to, in effect, con some money out of her father. And it's an odd thing, this thing so beautiful, talking about trying to separate her father from money is an odd thought. And it occurs rather early on in the opera, too. And dramatically, it's not of any particular significance. It just happens to be an absolutely gorgeous melody that you've all heard many, many times. One day I was, and you'll recognize it as soon as I start to play it. One day I was playing this at home. My then 13-year-old son came in and said, "I know that. That's beautiful." I said, "Ah. That's my boy. He's going to be a music lover." "Yeah, that's the background music for Grand Theft Auto." What's Grand Theft Auto, Chris? Well, I found out. But it shows you that this particular aria has legs. It's kind of everywhere. So let's listen to a little bit of Puccini's O mio bambino caro. Okay, let's pause it right there. Let's pause it. What's kind of neat about that right at the outset there? What's that? Why, again, do our spirits soar at that particular point? We've got a large leap there. It's a leap of an octave. We wouldn't expect you to recognize that, but it's interesting to fold that in because we were talking about octaves last time. So we have this opening phrase, and it's about to be coupled. We're going to continue now with the next phrase that will complete the antecedent phrase. So we'll listen, we'll just continue, please, Linda. So we're sitting here. Can you sing the tonic? Boom, that's where we want to go. Yeah, that's where we want to go. So we're in the step right above the tonic. So that's the end of the antecedent phrase, the opening up phrase, but we're not on the tonic. Okay. So now we're going to continue. And you can imagine we're going to hear some of that same music, but ultimately it's going to come back to the tonic, having gone away from it. Okay. A little more, please. Starting again. Here's our octave. Stop it right there. Now, something interesting happened there. Ah, there's our tonic. We should be back to our tonic. But that's not exactly what happened. We went to the tonic melody note, but underneath he harmonized it with an unexpected harmony. We expected to hear. We got. So we were deceived there a little bit. And musicians call this a deceptive cadence. A deceptive cadence. When the whole thing has been set up to come back to the tonic with the tonic chord underneath, we get something other than the tonic chord. So in music, we have two kinds of really broad categories of cadence. We have this kind of thing called, or where we come back to the expected tonic. We call those authentic cadences. We also have another class of, as mentioned, deceptive cadences, where we do things such as, we're expecting to go, but we go, or we go even more bizarre, something like that. You keep the same tonic note in the melody, but you change the harmony underneath. So that's what Puccini has done here. Instead of going there, he goes there. Here is a silly analogy. One time I was flying into the city of Minneapolis. The plane could fasten your seatbelts, everybody trays up, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. We're coming right in there. You can see the tarmac there, and suddenly the plane zoom, doesn't land, does a barrel roll almost off to the right, circles all the way around, announces there was some piece of equipment on the landing strip, and he was doing a flyover. In music, you have to do the same kind of thing. If a composer has set this up so that you're expecting to go, and you don't, you go here, we can't end that way. We just can't end that way. We need our daily supply of tonic. So what we got to do is a musical flyover. He's going to fly all around this thing again, and then come back in, and this time land on the tonic. So let's listen to the flyover. But it's so lovely he can't stop. So he's going to give you a little reminiscence of the beginning. There's our octave. Just a little reminiscent of the beginning, but again coming back, and this time, of course, ending on a tonic. So that's the structure of an aria by Puccini, and it is highly structured. It is highly structured. Now I want to talk about another aria that's structured in a different way, and that's by Richard Wagner. But before we do that, we need to talk about one other process in music, and that has to do with something called melodic sequence. And oddly, students over the years have had difficulty understanding and hearing melodic sequence. But it's a pretty simple idea. Melodic sequence is simply the repetition of a musical motive at a successively higher or lower degree of the scale. So I could take a motive. Anybody want to sing a motive for me here? Daniel, you want to sing a motive? Give me four notes. Yeah. Okay. So we've set up a descending melodic sequence. Now, supposing we did this. And so on. That's obviously an ascending melodic sequence. So that's what's involved here. And generally speaking, going down introduces relaxation, going up perhaps tension. All right, so that's a little bit of a setup with regard to that. So now we're going to work through this we'll call it an aria for the moment, of Wagner, in which, rather than structured units, he's going to continually evolve new music, but using a motive that he presses up continually through melodic sequence. So it's a slightly different process of melodic structure here. Richard Wagner, not a very nice man. Not a very nice man, needless to say. But he was a spectacular composer and wrote many great things. And one of them, arguably the best that he wrote, is his opera Tristan, Tristan and Isolde, written in 1865, as you can see on the board here. And we should know about it because we here at Yale own the piano on which Wagner wrote Tristan, or was at least involved in part of Tristan. Next time you are walking past DUH over there, you know, the health center, at 17 Hillhouse Avenue, there's a building there, rather foreboding looking building. Inside is a wonderful collection of keyboard instruments, so go in there sometime and look at the Bechstein piano, this German piano, Bechstein, that Wagner used when working on Tristan. So we have the opera, and we're going to start here with a little bit of the plot. It's a story of this English knight Tristan and this Irish princess Isolde, and it's Tristan's job to go over to Ireland and sort of pick her up and deliver her back to Cornwall, where she's supposed to marry King Mark. But on en route, they inadvertently consume a love potion. So she is passionately in love with him and he with her. So we're going to listen to a little bit of the overture here now. Wagner actually called it a prelude. That doesn't matter. Opening music here to Tristan. And I have two questions for you as we listen here. What instruments are playing, and what musical process is Wagner using at this point? Okay, Linda? So what instruments were playing there in that little dialogue, the dialogue between families of instruments? Strings and woodwinds, okay, alternating back and forth. The strings were at the lower point. Then the woodwinds would answer. Then strings. Okay, and then the third time. And so on. So what melodic process were they using there? Rising melodic sequence, rising melodic sequence. All right, and then it sort of chugged along until we got to... What's this? We talked about this before in regard to Richard Strauss. That sound? It's a dissonant sound resolving to consonant. So he uses these sequences to work up to a climax, hits a dissonance, resolves it into consonants. Let's listen to a little bit further along here in the prelude. Linda, if you could move it up to 7:10. Turning his way up here through sequence. Each level gets higher and higher in the violins. Mm-hmm. And you heard the trumpets come in there? With that chromatic figure, almost kind of like a snake rising through it. So it's not only the rising melodic sequences, this is highly chromatic music, and that also produces tension. How do you make love in music? Well, we've got rising dynamic volume here. We've got rising sequence. It works up to a climax where there is dissonance and then release. So if I'm using rather suggestive language here, it's done intentionally. This ain't Mary Poppins or The Sound of Music or Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs. This is the passionate story of Tristan and Isolde. Lust, desire, carnal knowledge, that sort of thing. And how does Wagner give you this sense? How does he communicate this? Well, this idea of continually rising sequence that then hits this climax with the dissonant, almost painful dissonance, and then the resolution. Music duplicating in an odd way life's processes. The climax of the opera, the real climax, however, really doesn't come until about 3 hours into it, at the end. Now we have Tristan dying of a mortal wound. Isolde is cradling him in her arms, and she sings an aria. We'll call it an aria. Wagner gave it a different name. It's called the Liebestod. She's singing about her vision of their life in the hereafter, in the world beyond, in the celestial realm. And so it's called a love death, a Liebestod here. And it's typical, I suppose, of conventions of the Romantic period, right? This is the 19th century, this is romance, Tristan and Isolde. So we're going to pick this up about halfway through the Liebestod of Isolde. And once again, we will hear these little snippets, these motives. Okay, I don't have absolute pitch. When you're really annoyed with things in life, you can sometimes at least make some fun, enjoy it somehow by trying to figure out what key it's in. Okay, so that was a pipe in F we were listening to, a rather unresonant pipe in F. Okay, so let's go back to the midpoint of the Liebestod here, and we're going to hear these little snippets. This is not antecedent consequent. This is a motive being pushed higher and higher each time to a climax. Here we go. It's glorious. It's glorious sound. And isn't it nice to have our audio system working properly again? This is really the first day that it's worked properly. So it sounds wonderful. It's glorious. It's a glorious climax that Wagner has been working for 3 hours here. And we've got that. We've arrived at it. But now he's going to turn everything around. The entire sentiment is going to change. And I think we should be able to enumerate here maybe as many as 4 different ways in which Wagner does turn our emotions 180 degrees at this point. So we're going to go back and we're going to listen to the climax again, and then we're going to listen to how the music changes. And I want you to, as you sit there, to think about what's he doing here? What you're the composer. How do you make something go from sort of cradle in your arms to vision of the world beyond? So think about dynamics, think about tempo, think about these sequences, consonants and dissonance, etc., etc., etc. Okay, here we go. Well, I hope you like that. Really gorgeous stuff. So get me started here. Get me started. What did you hear there? How did he sort of slow down this entire train? Yeah. Okay, the whole thing got softer. So we're going to take the basics first, and that would be sort of number one on my list. The whole thing got softer. What else happened? Not only soft, although the voice ended up rather high, what were the last sounds we heard? Also ended lower. And we've talked about high and low intention, that sort of thing before. Softer, maybe lower, generally in terms of the tessitura or the range. What else? Yeah, Chris, is it? Yeah.
The tempo got slower.
Oh yeah, there were some points that the tempo got slower. And we'll talk about that in just a minute if we hit on anything else here. Anything else? A little bit?
Fewer instruments?
They weren't playing as loud. They weren't quite as obvious. I'm not sure that there were fewer instruments. My guess is if I were to look at that score, it would be huge and everybody would still be playing. It's just it sounded fewer because they were playing more quietly. What about Roger? Sorry. Yeah, he used the dissonance. For example, we had that snake idea. It's like snake in the Garden of Eden. It was writhing around there, but then he took it up two more degrees and folded it into a consonant. So it was all very consonant at the end. What about the sequence? It was a... rising, 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 but here at the end it started doing. It's just repeating the same pitches over and over and over again. So he took that out of the equation too. He sort of backed out this idea of the sequence. It's static at this point. We have stasis, we have arrival, stability. What was the one thing that we haven't mentioned in terms of the tonality here? There at the end, what is that last sound? Very strongly the tonic. Yeah. That's the way it ended. There was one other thing that was kind of cool here. Trying to think of the exact. We had that kind of sound. Supposing I went. Does this have any resonance to you? Where are you if you hear this sound? Yeah. Maybe in a Yale commencement where we sing hymns or in a church or something like that, but we would call that an amen cadence. What does that bring to the, it sort of brings a divine benediction here. Now, the 19th century liked this more painful minor. But if you feel, if you have a sense here at the end that they're living a blessed existence in heaven, it may be because Wagner has folded in, sort of subliminally here below the surface, this cadence. We have deceptive cadences, and we have another kind of cadence here called an amen cadence that brings an additional resonance, an additional symbolism to the conclusion. So it's a wonderful piece of music, maybe I think we have time. Let's listen to just the last few seconds of that again, because it sort of recaps some of the points we've been making. Back it up even a couple seconds before that. Yeah, that's good. Here's the snake going away. Here's the consonants. Okay, good. So that's the Liebestod of Richard Wagner. Questions about that? Thoughts about that? Comments about that? All right, if not, let's go on to talk about Mozart, a little bit more about Mozart. We're going to hear another aria by Mozart. And this one does something a little bit different than, well, it's a kind of combination of what we've just studied here. We've got a highly structured aria by Mozart, yet at the same time we're going to see an example of rising melodic sequence in it. And we have a guest artist today, Lauren Libbill. So, Lauren, come on up. Some of you know Lauren. She's in Davenport College, and I've known her for years now because she is a music major, and I've seen her sing in lots of different productions of the School of Music's Orpheus in the Underworld a year or so ago. So, Lauren, and I know that you've sung with the Los Angeles Opera, and I remember that you sang with David Stern in Brussels. Was it Brussels or Paris or both?
Both,
yeah. Probably at the Châtelet in Paris?
Yeah.
Yeah, at the Châtelet Theater, the big metro change. In.
Yeah.
Yeah. So she's a very experienced singer and a very, very good singer. So, but tell us, Lauren, what do you want to do with this? Here you are at Yale, you could become an opera singer, or you could go to law school and work for Skadden Arps in New York or Los Angeles or whatever you want to do. What are you going to do with all this?
I would like to pursue a career in opera. Law school's not the road for me, although I do like to argue. Sorry, parents.
So you're going to have a go. So this year, then, if you're a senior, are you going to take a year off? Are you going to apply directly to graduate schools in voice? And where are you going to apply if you're going to do that?
Actually, I'm going to go back to work with David Stern in Paris for a year in a young artist program that they have there.
So you're in that already? Or?
Yeah, he... Very kindly has asked me for an
David answer. Stern was a Yale undergraduate. He is the son, and he was the nicest boy, too. The son of who? Of whom? Stern. Does that ring a bell? Isaac Stern, the world famous, the greatest violinist of the 20th century.
Yeah.
So David was an undergraduate here, graduated probably 15 or so years ago, and went on to a career in music as a conductor, mostly in Europe.
I think he told me that he was a TA for this class.
He would come in from time to time, and we would do things in here.
Yeah.
As an undergraduate, he was not a... Then he was conductor of the YSO for a couple of years, too. Yeah. So he would come in from time to time, and we would do different things. So Lars, as mentioned, a very experienced singer, and we're going to do a little aria here out of Mozart's Figaro, his opera The Marriage of Figaro, 1786, called Voi che sapete. So Lauren, can you tell us something about this aria? Who's singing it?
This aria is sung by Cherubino, who's a young boy, actually, though I'm clearly not a boy. I'm wearing pants for the purpose. Called a trouser roll for that reason, sung by a woman in this opera.
Why do they do that? What? Do these weird opera people like transvestites or something like this? There are other roles like this, just kind of a convention in opera, kind of a convention.
Yeah. He's a young boy, so maybe they thought the higher voice.
Yeah, that's right. He's an adolescent, 14, and what's he experiencing here?
First love, basically, mm-hmm. or first lust.
He's not sure.
He's not sure. So he's singing to the countess with whom he is in love, and with a little help from
Susanna.
Yeah.
So he thinks he's in love with the countess, but maybe it's Susanna, or maybe it's Barbarina, or maybe it's that broomstick over there. It's really hard to know exactly what he's in love with at age 14. And that's the confusion here. So there's a certain palpitation from time to time in the singing. It's intentional here, and a certain sense of being flustered, almost. You're agitated, you're flustered, you're uncertain what all these things are. We're going to have Lauren sing all of this for us. But in order to have this be something other than just a performance, I'd like to work through different pedagogical issues here. So let's talk about that just for a second. Now, at the outset of this, and you guys have your sheets out there, there's a sheet on the music stand back there. You've got a sheet, so take a look at that. And we'll see. What do you see, Marcus? Right down here in the front row. What do you see on your sheet by way of music?
It's broken up into two different parts.
Okay.
I guess three.
So, and they're labeled antecedent and consequent. So Mozart starts out here with the antecedent and consequent phrase structure. Was the antecedent, here comes consequent. So antecedent, consequent. Then, interestingly enough, when the voice comes in, what does he do, Lauren? What does he do there? You have to sing, you just don't duplicate what I do.
He actually expands the phrase structure, I guess, by adding more material in the middle, too.
So he had an A and B, but his mind is such, I mean, I'd never be able to figure that out. He thought, well, hey, I can open this whole thing up and put in some additional lovely music and then close it back down with my consequent phrase structure. So we have that. Let's listen to how that plays out. So we'll just start with where you come in, Laura, with voi, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And then we go on with a series of phrases, and as you listen to this, you might count the number of bars and phrases here. But generally speaking, they're all four bars in length. Mozart is one of the guys that sort of puts this whole idea of structure with melody on the map. Structure, symmetry are very important in his compositions. And as we proceed here, the text gets more and more interesting. We start talking about feelings at line five there. Sento d'un affetto. I feel, how would you, I guess we have a translation.
I feel affetto in Italian is like something.
Emotion? Yeah. And then sometimes he's really happy, and then sometimes he's sort of despairing. And what's kind of cool is when we get over to the despairing idea here on the piano, we're here and we go to. And then he's going to be burning like a flame and then freezing to death. So we get these weird harmonies out here as he's freezing and thawing. So let's hear just a little bit, maybe with from there at Sento d'Anafetto. Okay?
Sento d'affetto, vien ti desir, corrai nel letto, corrai partir. Geno e poi sento l'alba vampare.
Now we're going to go on to a little bit later. Lovely, lovely, lovely. We're going to go on to a little bit later, if you can follow on your text to sospire gemo, senza voler, palpito e tremo, senza sapere, and so on. What does Mozart do here in terms of structure?
It's a sequence, I think. he repeats the same series of notes progressively higher, sort of to illustrate Cherubino's rising angst slash emotion.
Good. So you pick it up in your B flat there, and I'll try to catch up. Yeah.
Sospiro e gemo senza voler, palpito e tremo senza saper. Non trovo pace notte né dì, ma pur mi piace.
So notice there how, as we come to the end of that, we work up there, we have the, it rises up through the melodic sequence, rising melodic sequence. We get, Lauren hits that high note up there and then comes off of it. That's the climax, the peak of the whole aria. And then the bass, what's the bass doing? It's sort of sneaking back down to the tonic, okay? So, and when we get back to the tonic, then comes in. We're going to pick it up from there, and Lauren, if you could, when we get, we're going to sing through that, when we get over there to ba-dee-da-dum, just hold on core, and we'll ask them a question. What happened here? What do we have here? Okay, when we, so if you can hold on that core, so from the voice.
Voi che sapete che cosa è amor, dove vedete se io l'ho nel cuor, dove vedete se io l'ho nel cuor.
Nice. Nice, that's a low note too. So what did Mozart do there? What was that? Had a deceptive cadence. Good, Marcus scores big today. So we're sitting here on this. We want it to go. But instead it goes. That's the core. And then we have our flyover. And that's the way it ends. So you come back to the tonic. Okay, we've arrived, we've landed. All right, I think we have time to do the whole thing now from beginning to end. And we'll get our pages in order. And so, Lauren Libau singing Voi che sapete from Mozart's Marriage of Figaro.
Voi che sapete
Lovely, lovely, lovely. Aren't we fortunate to have such talented students here at Yale? Okay, well, thank you all very much. We'll play a little more Puccini on your way out, and I hope you enjoy this day as beautiful as all this music has been.